you can draw. And all hands, shoot up. Yes, of course we can draw.
All of us.
What can you draw?
Anything.
How about a dog eating a fire truck in the jungle?
Sure. How big do you want it?
How many of you can sing?
Yes, of course we can sing.
What can you sing? What if you don't know the words?
That's okay. We'll make them up. Let's sing.
Now?
Line up.
How many of you can dance? What kind of music do you like to dance to?
Any kind. Let's dance.
Now? Sure, why not? Musical instruments?
Yes!
Do you write poetry?
Yes!
Can you read and write and count?
Yes!
We're learning that stuff now!
Try those same questions on a college audience. A few students will raise their hands when asked if they can draw or dance or paint or sing or act or play a musical instrument. More often than not, most students will want to qualify their responses with their limitations.
I play piano, but not very well. My mother made me.
Ali dances to rock and roll.
I only sing in the shower.
I only draw. Conclusions.
When asked why the limitations, college students answer,
I don't have any talent.
I haven't done any of that stuff since about the third grade.
Who's got the time?
That's not my major.
You can imagine the response to the same question asked of an older audience. What happened between kindergarten and now? What happened to, yes, of course I can.
What do you want to be in the play?
Well,
without giving up dignity or identity. He took it for granted that there was a place for pigs, and that the teacher would know that.
So what do you say to kids? Are you thinking a costume of pink long underwear, a pipe cleaner tail, and a paper cup for a nose? What do you say to a kid who doesn't see his career as an actor is teetering on the brink of utter humiliation?
And what do you say to all the pigs? All those who are different and do not accept the available boxes and pigeonholes.
So what did the teacher say to them?
Well, sometimes teachers talk a lot more like fairy godmothers. So be it.
Norman is declared the pig in the story of Cinderella.
And that was quite fine with the rest of the class. No one else wanted to be the pig anyway.
And since there was nothing in the script explaining what the pig was supposed to do, the action was left up to Norman. As it turned out, Norman gave himself one of the all-time best walk-on parts in the history of children's theater. He decided to do Cinderella's personal pig. Where she went, he went.
He made no sound. He simply sat on his back haunches and observed what was going on, like some slightly supportive Greek chorus.
The expressions on his face reflected the detail of dramatic action. Looking worried,
sad,
anxious,
hopeful,
puzzled,
mad,
bored,
sick,
and pleased, as the moment required.
There was no doubt about what was happening, and no doubt that it was important.
One look at the pig, and you just knew. He was so earnest, so sincere, so very there. Norman created such a dramatic tension that the people who knew how the story was supposed to end began to have doubts.
At the climax, when the prince finally placed the glass slipper on Cinderella's foot and the ecstatic couple hugged and rode off to live happily ever after, Norman finally made his move. He went wild with joy, dancing on the stage on his back feet.
Sooner or later, he would show up, all mad,
the way it was supposed to be played. There's hiding, and there's finding, we'd say. And he'd say, it's hide and seek, not hide and give up. And we'd all yell about who made the rules, and who cared about who anyway, how we would get, we wouldn't play with him anymore if we didn't get it straight. And things like that. Hide and seek, and yell. No matter what though, the next time he would hide too good again. He's probably still hiding somewhere, for all I know. This neighborhood game goes on, and there's a kid under my front window, hiding in a pile of leaves. He has been there for some time now. Everybody else is found, and they're about to give up on him over at the base. I considered going out to the base and telling them where he is hiding. I thought about setting the leaves on fire. Finally, I just yelled, "Get found, kid!" It's hard to know how to be helpful sometimes. A man I know found out after he had terminal cancer. He was a doctor and knew about dying. He didn't want to make his family and friends suffer through that with him. So he kept his secret and he died. Everybody said how brave he was to bear his suffering in silence, but privately, his family and friends said how angry they were that he didn't need them, didn't trust their strength. They were hurt that he hadn't said goodbye. He hid too good. Getting found would have kept him in the gates. Hide and seek, grown-up style, wanting to hide, needing to be sought, confused about being found. Better than hide and seek, I like a game called Sardines. Now, in Sardines, a person who is it goes and hides, and everybody goes looking for him. But when they find him, they don't let anybody know. Instead, they get in and hide their wit. Pretty soon, everybody's hiding together, all stacked in a tree like a pile of puppies. And then somebody giggles. And then somebody laughs. And everybody gets found. By the sound of laughter, everybody gets found.
Lying at last.
Really getting up there.
Still sitting.
Yes. 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 Oh, yes.
When the dream is held close to the heart and imagination is applied to what is close at hand, everything is still possible.
Down to the final awesome moment. uplifted, exalted, excited, affirmed, overwhelmed man alive!
Out of all that trouble and sorrow, out of all that frustration and disappointment, comes majesty and joy. He defied his fate with jubilation, so I can't just sit around in my winter ash heap wringing my hands feeling sorry for myself in the face of that music.
Not only does it cure spiritual rot, it probably cures colds too.
One day, on some incredible December night, I'm going to rent myself a grand hall and a mighty symphony orchestra and an amazing choir. Stand on the podium and conduct the night. And I will personally play the kettle drum part all the way through while simultaneously singing along at the very top of my lungs. And in the awesome silence that follows, I will bless all the gods that be for Ludwig van Beethoven, for his night and his life.
Man alive!
The rake is procured, and Donnie, the deputy raker, goes to work in the fast-falling November twilight.
In silence, he rings. And in silence, I watch him through the window of the dark house. Are there any sounds at all in his mind, I wonder? He rakes the leaves into a large pile, as instructed. Of course, I shall spread them out over the yard again after he's gone. I am stubborn about this. But he goes back over the yard, picking up his leaves by hand and carrying them to the pile. He's stubborn about his values. Raking the leaves means all the leaves. He signs to me that it is getting dark, that he must go home to eat, and leaves the work unfinished. Having paid him in advance, I wonder if he will return. At my age, I'm getting cynical. But, come morning, he has returned to his task, and after much meticulous work, the yard is leaf-free. He reports to the door, signing that the work is done. And as he walks away up the street, I see him tossing one helicopter seed into the air after another, a fringe benefit. And I stand in my own door in silence, smiling at grace, a fringe benefit. Tomorrow, I will go out to the yard, and I will push that pile of leaves over the embankment into the ravine behind our house. I will do it in silence. The leaves will have to work out their destiny down there this year. I wouldn't have the heart to undo his work. My scientific experiment will just have to stand aside for something more human. The leaves have let go, the trees have let go, and now it is time for me to let go and cast my lot with this pile, who, like the seed, is one of nature's tenacious survivors. Hold on, Donnie.
Worse, I know that the
stuff can congeal, mush, mutate into some living thing that can crawl out of the sink at the night and get loose in their house.
Come
to think of it, my father never came closer than 3 feet to the sink in his life. My mother said he was lazy, but I knew that he knew that I knew about the stuff in the sink. I told him once, I bet Jesus never had to clean dishes in washing the sink. He agreed. It was the only theological discussion we ever had.
Thank you.
1859 at the Feather River Inn in the town of Fullerton in the Sierra Nevada Mountains of Northern California. And I, just out of college, have a night job that combines being the night desk clerk at the lodge and helping out with the horse wrangling at the stables. The owner slash manager is Italian Swiss, with European notions about conditions of employment.
He and I do not get along. I think he's a fascist who wants peasant employees, and he thinks that I'm a good example of how democracy can be carried too far. 1 week, the employees have been served the same thing for lunch every single day. 2 wieners, a mound of sauerkraut, and stale rolls. To compound insult with injury, the cost was then deducted from our pay. I was outraged. On Friday night of that awful week, the night auditor had just come on duty, and I was at my desk job around 11 o'clock and went into the kitchen to grab a bite to eat and found notes to the chef that wieners and sauerkraut were on the employees' menu for 2 more days.
That tears it. I quit.
For lack of any better audience, I unloaded on the night auditor signaling woman.
I have had it up to here. I'm gonna get a plate of wieners and sauerkraut, ring up the owner, and throw it on him. I'm sick and tired of this crap and insulted. No one is gonna make me eat wieners and sauerkraut for a whole week and make me pay for it. This is not American. I don't even like wieners and sauerkraut enough to eat for 1 day, for God's sake. And the whole hotel stinks, and all the guests are idiots, and I'm packing my bags, and I'm moving to Montana with
My monologue was delivered at the top of my lungs, punctured by
blows on the front desk,
the kicking of chairs,
and much profanity.
A call to arms.
Freedom! Unions and the breaking of chains for the working masses!
As I pitched my fit, Sigmund Woman looked at me with sorrowful eyes. Put a bloodhound in a suit and you've got Sigmund Woman. Had a good reason to look sorrowful. Survivor of Auschwitz, 3 years, German Jew. He liked the night job, gave him intellectual space, gave him peace and quiet. And even more, he could go into the kitchen and grab a bite to eat whenever he wanted to. All the wieners and sauerkraut he wanted. To him, a feast. And even more, there was no one at the night job to tell him what to do. In Auschwitz, he'd only dreamed of such a time. The only one he sees at work now is me, the nightly disturber of his dreams. And here I am, a one-man war party at full cry.
No! Why?
Listen to me. You know what's wrong with you? It's not the wiener and the crowd. And it's not the boss, and it's not the chef, and it's not this job.
What's wrong with me?
You think you know everything, but you don't even know the difference between an inconvenience and a problem. If you break your neck, if you have nothing to eat, if your house is on fire, you've got a problem. Everything else is an inconvenience. Life is inconvenient. Life is lumpy. You learn to know the difference between an inconvenience and a problem. You'll live longer. And you won't annoy people like me so much. Good night.
There, in the late night darkness of Feather River Inn, Sigmund Woman had simultaneously kicked my butt and opened up a window into my mind. Problem or inconvenience. I call this the woman test of reality. Life is lumpy, but a lump in the oatmeal, a lump in the throat, and a lump in the breast are not the same kind of lump. We should learn to know the difference. Good night, Sid.
At this time, there will be a 15-minute intermission. There is a concession stand open in the hallway. Please be aware that no food or drink is allowed in the theater at any time. So please enjoy your refreshments in the hallway.
Apple.
Uh-oh.
She
lived too.
Ever since then, humankind has been composing a symphony of short syllables
that represent complex thoughts.
Everybody knows it. It's inside, 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 inside
has been sung? Have you ever heard anybody go?
Ah!
No! Maybe because it was the life adventure in such clear and simple terms. Human beings have been coping with disasters and catastrophes for a long time. We are survivors, and we teach our kids about that. And maybe spiders teach their kids about it too, in their spider sort of way. The small creature is alive and looks for adventure. Here's the drain pipe, a long tunnel going towards some light. The spider doesn't even think about it, just goes. Disaster befalls it, rain floods powerful forces, and the spider is flushed down and not far beyond where he started. Does the spider say,
"Aw, to hell with it"?
No. Sun comes out, clears things up, dries off the spider. And the spider goes over to the drain pipe, looks up at things.
I really wonder what's up there.
But it's a little wiser now. Checks the sky first, looks up at the toeholes, says a spider prayer, and heads up through.
Mystery.
Toward the
light.
And wherever.
Along the table was loaded
she hosed the front of the chancel, hitting two bridesmaids, the groom, a ring bearer, and the minister. I'm quite sure the details. We have it all on videotape. Three cameras were. The MOTV had bought up everything.
Having disgorged hors d'oeuvres, champagne, and the last of her dignity, the bride went limp in her father's arms, while her groom sat down where he had been standing, too stunned to function.
And the mother of the bride moaned, slumped over, and passed out cold.
There was a fire drill then and there at the front of the church!
Groomsmen, must have gone heroically.
Many friends have fought for us.
Whoa!
Bridesmaids, stop!
And people with stomachs headed for the exits. The smell of fresh wretch drifted across the church.
Only two people were seen smiling. One was the mother of the groom. The other was the father of the bride.
What happened next?
Well, we all went back to real life. Guests were invited to endure back to the reception hall. No, they didn't eat or drink as they might have in different circumstances. The bride was consoled, cleaned up, and fitted out in a bridesmaid's dress, and hugged and kissed aloft by the groom. She will always love him for that. When he said, for better or worse, he meant it. The cast reassembled where we left off. A single flute played a quiet air. The words spoken and deeds done. Everybody cried as people were supposed to do at weddings. Mostly because the groom held the bride in his arms through the whole ceremony. And no groom has kissed the bride more tenderly than he.
If one can hope that their wedding be memorable, then theirs was a raging success. No one who was there will ever forget it.
They lived as happily ever after as anyone lives. Happier than most, in fact. They've been married about 12 years now and have three lively children.
That's not the end of the story. On the 10th anniversary of this disastrous affair, a party was held. A feast was laid, best friends invited.
And three cheese sets were mustard.
Remember, there are three being cameras at the scene of the accident. All three were shown at once.
The effect? Pretty interesting.
Especially with the running commentary and the stop action stuff.
That's pretty gross to see. One frame at a time.
Pickle juice and is experiencing what might be nicely described as
significant fluid loss. Tears mixed with mucus from a runny nose, mixed with blood from a small forehead abrasion, mixed with saliva from an open, drooling mouth, making a noise to send a dog under a bed. The father has remained surprisingly calm and still in the face of this catastrophe. This is because the father is thinking about running away from home, quietly turning and walking away because nobody knows this is his kid, getting in the car, driving to California maybe, changing his name, getting a job as a paper boy or a line cook in an online diner, something, anything that does not involve contact with three-year-olds. Oh, sure, someday he may find this amusing, but in the most private part of his heart, he is sorry he married, sorry he grew up, sorry he had children, and most of all, sorry he can't train in this particular son for a model that works. He cannot and will not say these things to anyone, ever. But they are there, and they are not funny. Later, in the car, in the parking lot, the father will hold the sobbing child in his arms until he falls asleep. He drives home and carries the child up to his crib. The father stares at the sleeping child for a long time. He does not run away from home.
This is 1976. The same father faces the living room. In his hand is what's left of a letter, crumpled into a ball and uncrumpled again. The letter is from his 16-year-old son, the same son from the picnic, deprived of his father's eye, or was until today's memory. The tables have turned. Now it is the son who's running away from home. He says he hates his father and wishes he's never had one. He says the father is a jerk and a failure as a parent, and ends with, "You can kiss my butt and drop dead." The father is shouting at the ceiling, "Why me? Why me? Why me?" Well, the answer is simple. He has a son. His son is 16. It happens. Someday, some long day from now, he may laugh about even this. What does that have to do with God?
And I knelt beside my bed and prayed, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. I thought about my grandfather and what a big shout he was, because the prayer ends with, For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever, amen. I went to bed feeling pretty well connected to the universe for a long time.
You're putting me on, right?
No, not at all. See, I belong to the whole big scheme of things. I lived and worked and had my being in the family store. The whole universe was the Howard family enterprise.
So, do you still believe in Howard?
Let me put it this way. The 13th century Christian mystic, Meister Eckhart, said, The eye with which I see God is the same eye with which God sees me.
What the hell is that?
Not only do I believe in Howard, but Howard believes in me.
Four months later,
on about bedtime, he seems to forget all about it. And we never do get to Christmas.
Christmas Eve and good memories seem to be enough. So this has happened 5 times now. Once in July, once in October, twice in December, and now in February. Each time, he asks me to tell him about his childhood again. And I do. I've gotten so good at lying about how wonderful it is, I almost believe it myself. Each time, I just call my daughters and say, Merry Christmas, into the phone, and here they come. They always bring presents and bake cookies and sing carols, the whole thing. Twice, we've even gotten as far as putting up a tree. They love to do it.
Just then, old Freddy comes shuffling back in the hallway.
Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Hey, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
You see, the girls don't really think of it as Christmas anymore. They kind of think of it as Father's Day. And I like to think of it as Valentine's Day. Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
how utterly amazing it all is. And that somehow, sometimes, things are just as they should be.
Like
faces, only if I reflect them.
I am a fragment of a mirror, whose whole design and shape I do not know. Nevertheless, with what I have, I can shine light into dark places, into dark hearts of men, and change some things in some people. Perhaps others may see and do likewise. This is what I'm about. This is the meaning of my life.
And then he took a small mirror, holding it carefully, caught the bright rays of daylight streaming through the window, and reflected them onto my face and onto my hands, folded on the classroom desk.
Are there any questions?
Are there any questions?
Are there any questions?
Are there any questions?
Are there any questions?